Happy hump day, sippers and speakers. Welcome everyone to Saki's Speakeasy podcast, where I speak easily on various topics that cross my mind throughout the day. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me your most precious commodity, your time. You could be anywhere else right now, but you're here reading a book in the Speakeasy with me, so welcome. Please take a moment to show my moderators some love and affection, moving in the right direction, as they are running around all blue-lipped and out of breath, keeping us safe in the Speakeasy. So love them up a little bit. And while you're at it, please make sure you like, share, comment, and if you haven't already, go ahead and hit that subscribe button, okay? Become a sipper and a speaker and click that notification bell so you'll be notified each time I go live. Welcome to my new subscribers. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Thank you for subscribing to the channel. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers. Hey, y'all. Hey, I love each and every one of you. And make sure everybody is following me on Twitter and Instagram at Saki's Speakeasy. So before we spread the legs on the next chapter of this book, because child, yesterday was a whole lot of Let me see who's here. Hey, Love Jones, my little quietly learning in the back all day super sniper. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. And Bikini Body Challenge, that's my little sneaky laughing super sniper right there. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here as well. I appreciate you. And you too, Marva. Good afternoon, darling. Thank you so much for being here in the Speakeasy with us. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Kim Bird. Good afternoon, darling. How are you today? I'm so happy that you're here. Welcome, welcome. And you too, learning. They travel together. Like good girlfriends should. I know that's right. Welcome, darling. Thank you as well for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. I think I got everybody. And for those of you that are in the clouds and the shrubbery, thank you for being here too. And go ahead and smash that like button, okay? So listen, y'all. Yesterday, she who has no name. We don't know her name, y'all. We are 10 chapters in, and we don't know her name. We know her husband's name. We know his mistress's name. We know his mistress's husband's name. We know her boss's name, her co-worker's name. Hell, we even know her friend's boyfriend's name. Good googly moogly. We know everybody's name. Except for her. I don't know what to say about that. Maybe it's none of our goddamn business. So we just gonna keep on reading. Listen, do we really give a damn what her name is when we can be all up and through her biz? I think not. Chapter 11. Charles raises his voice. Where have you been all night? He's upstairs in the master bedroom. His voice comes down the hallway and meets me. I don't know how I feel. I'm a passenger on a train that has no destination. On the drive home, with the top down, chrome spinning. No, I'm just kidding. It didn't say chrome spinning. With the top down, as the cold breeze chilled my flesh, I felt like a woman who was going back to her castle to slay the dragon. For a few miles, I was so certain about my purpose. Now I feel like a wife who has violated the seventh commandment. Or is that the sixth? I don't even know what part of the Decalogue I've desecrated. Either way, I feel like a church girl who's moved off grid, and now I'm on the express train to hell. Charles's footsteps are heavy. He's upstairs, coming down the hallway, moving fast. I close the front door and stand there, unmoving, wondering if I should have gone to Yvette's or maybe to a hotel to clear my head. But this is my home. The castle I helped by working all those long hours at a stressful job. He stops at the top of the stairs, up in the loft area that we use as a library. I can't see him, but I feel his energy. It's on high, heating up the house, almost in the red zone. It's close to sunrise, an hour that I haven't seen in ages. Charles turns on the light in the upstairs hallway and then comes down to the landing. He's barefoot and has on deep blue old navy pajama bottoms and a rust-colored wife beater. Again, he asks, where have you been? When I don't answer, he breathes fire, takes hard steps, comes halfway down the rest of the stairs, tells me that my job and Yvette have been calling here all evening. I don't hide from Charles. I click the light on so he can get a better view of his wife. His expression changes. He sees a woman whose locks are tousled, wearing wrinkled clothing, dried sweat on her face, maybe smells the scent of a strange man rising from her flesh. I see a man with a swollen eye, a man who was almost gunned down in a school parking lot, a man who's been tossing and turning all night, maybe for the last few days. Lies and guilt and fear create pillows made of concrete, make the softest comforter feel like it's made of stone. I stand at the bottom of the stairs, purse in hand, and return his glare. I'm scared. Scared of who we are now. Scared of who I am now. I'm a third person hovering over this room, staring at two people I don't know. I ask, was it easy for you to fuck her and come home? Don't walk in here talking like that. You know what's fucked up? I could have become a widow and never known why. Not now, he snaps. Let's not do this now. We do it when I say we do it, Charles, I snap back. Everything becomes volcanic when I see him. Those words, all the things he said and shared with his lover for all those months, all of that pissivity bubbles under my skin. I say, after you fucked her the first time, you should have come home and repented your sins, but you went on like nothing had happened. Head to toe, over and over, he takes me in, and you would have gone on like nothing had happened. Forever. My words rouse him. I say, for 8 months, you kept fucking that bitch and coming home to me. His eyes widen and his anger changes to fear. Again, he takes in my wrinkled clothing, my messed up mane, maybe gets a whiff of the wine that rides from my breath. I ask, was it a couple of times, Charles? Was it only twice in 8 months? That vein rises in his neck, moves up and down with his rapid heartbeat. I want him to fight. I need him to be that dragon so I can slay him. But Charles isn't a dragon. He's a man. The man I married. I ask, you did answer those questions, right? He hesitates, fingers opening and closing. Those questions are unreasonable. And having sex with another man's wife was reasonable? His hands remain closed, in fists. I own a don't fuck with me tone. You know I can find out what I really want to know. Look, where his voice is harsh, but he stops, his nostrils flaring. He pulls himself together, softens his tone, but can't get out his words. He repeats, where have you been? This time, the way he asks that question changes. He wants to know what I know. I give him a thin smile. I almost laugh. Questioning me is ludicrous. When I start up the stairs, he grabs my left arm. His grip is tight, a combination of desperation and irritation. I look at him like he's insane, then struggle and yank away. I snap, touch me again, until death do us part will come a lot sooner than either one of us has planned. He raises his palms in apology, and I hurry by him. He's never manhandled me like that, but we've never been like this. I'm so nervous that I drop my purse when I get to the top of the stairs. The sheets of paper that were on top of my things scatter across the carpet. Charles rushes up, stands near me. My heart beats faster. I gather those sheets of paper and throw them at his face. Wish they all were stones. He asks, what's this? I head to the bedroom and slam the door. I catch my breath and drop my purse in the leather chair. I wait for the dragon to come after me. Wait for the door to fly off of its hinges. It's silent in the hallway, a strong silence that can be heard for miles. Those papers were pages of messages between him and his lover. I stole those. I'm not stupid. No way was I going to leave David Lawrence's studio without evidence of the crime. Jessica, 6:18 a.m. Busy today? Charles, 6:18 a.m. Going to church, then the wifey is running to work after that. Jessica, 6:18. David has an art show in San Diego, so he's gone for the weekend. Charles, at the same time. A smiley face. Jessica returns a smiley face. Charles, I'll be free by 2. Jessica, want you to be grabbing my ass by 3. Charles, by 2:30. I imagine that Charles is outside that door, stunned, reading with his mouth wide open, then taking long, deep breaths and closing his eyes before he lets it all back out. Jessica, thinking about you had me wiggling in my sleep. I dreamed about you. Woke up fiending for some more. Charles, same here. We must be needing each other bad. Jessica, I wish I could please you again right now. Never had sex that good before. You're making a woman weak. Keep saying I'm going to be right. Then I get to work and see you. Look in your eyes, and all I want to do is be with you. Jessica, I want to make every fantasy a reality for you. Just give me time, Jessica. I love you. I want us to be together, Charles. You know that's too complicated right now, Jessica. I just hate thinking that anybody is touching you besides me. You make me happy, make me want to be better than I already am. I am so blessed to have you. I won't get to be with you until Thursday, Charles. Thursday seems like a month away. He's out there doing the same thing I did when I read the lust letters, hoping the words will change, that this reality will disappear. Jessica, call me. Want to see you. Charles, okay, we'll call you later. She got called in to work. Jessica, call me at home ASAP. Charles, only on the cell. Don't get sloppy. Jessica, I don't care about that anymore. Charles, don't get careless. Jessica, he doesn't get back from Canada until Thursday. Charles, that's no excuse. Don't get careless. Jesse, Jessica, call me right now. Charles, told you I'm not alone yet. Jessica, we need to talk about how we're going to handle our situation. We need to figure out how we're going to do this. Jessica, hello, Charles. Be patient. Charles says, Jessica, can't wait anymore. Not being with you is torture. We need to talk. Jessica, hello? You there? Jessica, hello? Charles, I'll call you when she leaves. Jessica, you're the love of my life. Can't imagine living another day without you. The bedroom is a mess. Bed unmade. Three empty cans of Strohs are on the nightstand. Clothes everywhere, like he's had a fit. Black boxing gloves are in the middle of the floor. Sweaty clothes are hanging over the side of the bathtub. His heavy boxing bag was down in the garage, blocking my parking space. That's why I had to park in the driveway and come in through the front door. He's been working out his anger today, trying to recapture his youth, banging that heavy bag like he's getting ready for the rematch of his life. When I look in the bathroom mirror, a rainbow of colors has dried on my face and neck, even on my breasts. The reds and yellows, traces of the paint that came from David Lawrence's flesh, have streaked and speckled my skin. Even with my heart racing, the drumbeat of David Lawrence echoes between my legs. Ooh, David put it down. I turn on the shower, then stare out at the sunrise. Charles is still silent. He has to be reading the last page by now. Subject, what I feel for you. Time, 11:34:02 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time. From Jessica to Charles, every time you touch me, a part of me walks away from him. Every time we leave our haven, our heaven. I feel guilty, not for what we did, but for leaving you. I sit with my husband, talk with my husband, eat dinner with my husband, and I feel alone. I'm broken, a woman who is living many lives in many pieces. I have to see movies twice. I go with him and pretend that it's all new to me. And I know you do the same. This treachery is making me weary. Do you know how hard it is to be in love with someone and I can't tell anyone? I can't put a picture of you up. I can't even own one. Do you know how bad I want to call you right now? I can't call you. I can't wait for your calls because I know you're not going to call. I can't look at you too long at work. I can't speak your name in the tone it deserves, the one that rises from my heart. I can't make love to you and wear our aroma. I have to wash away all traces of us before I leave the room. And when I watch you do the same, see how careful you are, the way you make sure you have all of your belongings, how you make sure you leave with the same scent you left home wearing, one that has no traces of me. I remember the day you left your watch at the hotel, how you freaked out, had to go back and get it. Then you explained that your watch was a present from your wife. I said nothing, but now I hate that watch. Hate when you look at it to see how much time we have, because in my mind, you're looking at her. Now I see how you keep all of your things in a neat pile so nothing will be forgotten. It bothers me. We wash each other as if we're washing the lies off our bodies. We shouldn't be ashamed of what we have, of what we feel. I'm even afraid to dream about you because I might wake up in a haze moaning your name. We're going out less and less, spending most of our time in rented rooms, rooms that many others come to rest in, to make love in, then go. I wish we could have our own space, our own heaven, our own sheets that are unsoiled by the sins of others. I want a place where I can put pictures of us up. Maybe I can get us a place during the summer an apartment. So when the both of us are off work for those months, we can come and go as we please, a place where I can wait for you or you can wait for me. And we can bathe and massage each other. We can leave each other love letters. I love you, and I've never spent the night with you. I've never seen you in the morning's light. What we have has gravity, the kind that I can't ignore. I'll give up all I have and eat rice and beans if you tell me that we can grow old together. Your touch is liberation. What I feel for you is incurable. As always, you are the love of my life, the one I can't live without. Forever goes by before Charles opens the bedroom door. He walks in, bouncing those sheets of paper against his leg, and stares at my reflection in the mirror. His voice booms. When did she give you this? That confuses me, but only for as long as it takes me to blink. He's smoldering. What did she tell you? He's pissed because he thinks I've been chilling with Jessica, that I've had a clandestine tryst with his lover. His ignorance is bliss. That almost makes me smile. I chuckle and say, I'll tell you this. I tell him how his affair started, almost pinpoint the date. Tell him about their wonderful night at the soldiers' play. I tell him about that first kiss, the one that lasted for an hour. I don't play all my cards, just enough to throw off his game and halt his lies. He shakes his head, speaks in a definite tone. Don't believe her. Where we are now, it's sad, so very sad. We're children in adult clothes. All of the education we have, it gets stripped away, and this is what we become. He reacts to me, and I react to him. Charles has taken away my choices. If he had come to me with honesty, I could have decided what I could do to fix it. But I can't fix something if I don't know it's broken. Now he wants to talk. I turn the shower off because I want to hear what he has to say. He sits on the arm of the chair, takes a breath, and tries to explain the unexplainable. My husband tells me that it was an affair of convenience, not one from the heart. Let's not pretend, I tell him. Right now, we're not friends. Deception has put a rift in whatever friendship I thought we had. Okay? By choosing to be with Jessica, by not coming to me and telling me what was wrong, by not giving me a chance to work on our problems, you took away my choice. I didn't. When you slept with Jessica, that's what you did. Okay. So, I took away your choice. What did you do? I hadn't slept with anybody else since we started going out. I don't mean since we got married. I mean since we began dating. That's over 5 years. What did you? I took away your choice. He pauses, closes his eyes. What the hell does that mean? Don't get stupid on me. His face looks like it's in a million pieces, a puzzle ready to fall apart. His saliva is thick, almost glues his mouth. He furrows his brows and asks, who? A stranger. A stranger? Somebody I just met yesterday. His hurt is so deep he trembles. How could you? How could I? That question makes me explode just like Tyra the Tyrant. Charles tries to smother my anger by exploding as well, but trying to shut me down makes me angrier. Our shouting match rumbles our peaceful home. I yell, I cry, I tell him about the movies, the plays, all the things I know he's done with Jessica. I tell him the shit that he said about me. My words shut him down. My emotions exhaust me. We hit a calm. Sit in the eye of the hurricane. The echoes of the screams fade. Silence return. Birds are singing outside our window. People in our planned community are driving to work. The sun continues to rise. I ask, when did things change for us? The easiness of my voice, its earnestness, catches him off guard. He clears his throat, rubs his face. He looks numb. My hurt has run deep, has wounded his hypocritical ego. He says, hard to say when. Hard to give a date. Try. I think things started to change when we went to Jackson, Mississippi. In Mississippi? Yeah, last year at your grandfather's funeral. How did going to Papa's funeral change anything? He tells me that at my paternal grandfather's funeral, I didn't cry. He tells me how I sat there so detached, looking so cold. All around me, my relatives and Papa's friends were crying, expressing sorrow. But I sat there, no tears in sight. People watching says that I reminded him of the news reporters at the shop, the way they reported on death without expression. That's bullshit, Charles, and you know that. This is who you are. I called you day before yesterday. He motions at his wounded eye, and no matter how I got hurt, you called me and lied. Look, let's forget about that for the moment. He shakes his head and lets out a rueful laugh. No matter how I was injured, I told you I had a busted eye. I was scared to death. And 2 seconds later, you were yakking about me watching some stupid news report on a woman who got bit by a pit bull. What kind of shit is that? I snap. I was at work, Charles. He retorts, that's where your priorities are. I was at work, at work, at work. That's what I do. Yeah, that's what you do. You become insensitive. You turn off your emotions. You refuse to feel. And you do it well. And you do it all the time. I deal with death, rape, negative shit every day. I can't turn it on and off. I understand that if you're at work. But I'm talking about after work. Do you really understand? You think I don't deal with negative shit at work every day between kids and parents? And do I bring that shit home and dump it on you? You do. And you know you do. Not every day. You just don't understand what my job is like. I understand. I don't think you do. How can I not? Your stress becomes my stress every time you come in that door. All I'm doing is sharing my day with you. It's called communication. My words fade and I pull at my locks, then massage my temples. I recoup and say, I'm successful. Success cannot be attained without hard work, commitment, and determination. Of course, you're successful. You make the lion's share of the income. You're the head nigga in charge in this house. I pause. Is that what this is about? Well, you were so quick to point out that I would need $50,000 to buy you out of the equity in this house. Our marriage hits a speed bump. Are you insane? And the first thing you do is calculate your losses. Don't confuse a speed bump with a brick wall. It came down to money. I have to protect myself financially and emotionally. That's very Dr. Laura of you. That's being real. I've worked too hard to lose all I have because you met some bitch. You're sitting over there trying to make it sound like your affair was nothing. He goes on, if you're successful, the producer who rides off to Hollywood every day, and I'm a middle school teacher out in the friggin' desert, what am I? What? I'm not saying that I'm successful and you're not. Yes, you are. You're successful at work, but not here, not between these four walls. That hits me hard. My mouth opens. Lips move, but my words crumble. I can't talk. He says, can you honestly tell me that you thought everything was okay with us? Yes. Bullshit. I'm not saying I thought we were perfect. No one is. I didn't think that it, that we, that our marriage, our friendship, didn't think that it was like this. We sit here in our truth. It's not pretty. It's not comfortable. It's the way truth is. He rubs his hands together, still bouncing his leg. You think your work is hard? It's so draining. Well, so is mine. I'm a teacher, a coach, a referee, a counselor, a surrogate parent to every black kid that has no dad at home, and that's damn near all of them. He stops and rocks. They look up to me. Do you know how hard it's going to be for me to go back to work to be their hero? How hard it's going to be for me to face them with this shit? Well, let me stop right here. You should have kept your dick in your pants, pimpin'. Sorry? The fuck? You want to be their hero, but behind closed doors, you fucking somebody else's motherfucking wife while your wife is at home sleeping after a hard night's work. Fuck you, Charles. Fuck you. Well, you caused this humiliation. Own it. He chuckles. Yep, you can be one cold fish. I pull my lips in. I'm not going to let you turn this around. I'm not the dragon. He takes a breath and goes on. Last year, I told you that we found out a kid was pregnant, a 13-year-old, an African-American, one of ours. One of the teachers did it. What does that pedophile have to do with? And the first thing you did was try to figure out how to make it a story. What? I didn't. You did, he nods. Did you forget that you were pregnant at 15? Guess you forgot how that felt. Did you forget how scared you were? His words almost extinguished the fire inside me. His voice softens. Jessica cried about it, didn't detach herself. She didn't try to make it a special report for the damn 10 o'clock news. She did what real people do. She cried. He wipes his eyes with the backs of his fists. He says we're supposed to protect kids, not exploit. I'm stunned. And I cried too. His lip trembles. I felt like I was that kid's parent, you know? A lot of responsibility comes with my job. I do my best and it hurt me because it felt like I had failed her. I called you that day, needed you. And I was in pain and you... He stops and shakes his head. He says, you wanted to know what made me go to Jessica. Now you know. It's the subtle moments that make you fall in love with someone or out of love. Too many hurtful moments make you want to pull away. We've had a lot of those moments. You should have come to me, Charles. When have you been available? Every damn day. I'm here every damn day. I sleep in that bed with you every night. Damn it. You could have come to me 8 months ago. You should have come to me 8 months ago. I had to get a mortifying phone call at my job. Her husband had to hunt you down like you were an animal, beat your ass at your job. Then he came to my damn job with this shit, and I had to read. I motioned at the white pages of instant messages that litter the beige carpet. That, all of that, to find out the truth. I could be a widow right now. Imagine me getting that shit after somebody had killed you over words stick in my throat. He looks at those pages. He asks, what did she tell you? I've become a situation. I motion at those papers. I know more than that. A lot more. She kept every word you ever sent her. I've seen most of it. He groans, tries to say things, but all he gives me is, I'm sorry. Sorry? This wasn't an accident. You took her to restaurants, to plays, to museums. You planned. My voice remains deflated, distant. You had your own little Wawa girl, paraded her up and down the 405 freeway. Guess that was your own little Route 13. What? You violated another man's wife in hotels, cars, anywhere she would spread her legs. You swam in her for 8 months. Right now, I don't give a shit about Papa's funeral or the pregnant kid or any excuse you throw in my face to make this seem like it's my goddamn fault. God's last name ain't damn, and mother's last name ain't fucker, but you're acting like one right now. Don't talk like that. I hate it when you chose to put your dick in that man's wife over and over and over and came home and did the same to me over and over. Went on like everything was fine. Am I proud of it? His voice fills with conviction. No. Was I going to leave you? Thought about it. Would I leave you? No. Despite all the things I've said or done, you're my wife and I love you. You are the love of my life. When did you realize that? Before or after Jessica's husband hunted you down? Maybe I should take a crew from the station and go down to the school and find out. He barks, you will not go to my job. Try me. Do you understand? This is not a damn news story. This is my life. This is my damn life too. Don't. Just don't. His threatening tone, the way he looks, all of that frightens me. He rubs his face, calms a bit, but can't stop rubbing. Hand over hand. Charles says, I can't imagine myself being with anybody but you. If I wanted anybody else, you could have this house, my pension, whatever you think this is all about, and I would be gone. Would I do it over? No. Would I have gone on and not let you find out about it? I don't know. Can't say yes, can't say no. Am I glad you know? In some ways, yeah. I feel relieved. Do you? Yeah, I do. Good. At least one of us feels better. Again, loud and unnerving silence lives in this room. The sun is up. No more darkness. He stares at my wrinkled clothing. I stare at his swollen eye. Did you? His voice almost breaks. He swallows, straightens his back, his eyes intent set on mine. His voice comes back stronger, gives me hard eye contact. Now he's the man. You slept with somebody? He wants me to change my answer. His voice demands me to, needs me to, wants me to erase my scarlet letter and salve his wounded ego. I nod. He groans. He asks, you went out and a stranger? I nod. Bit by bit, his face changes. Jealousy rises and gives him insane eyes. Then he blinks and looks mortally wounded. For a moment, he has the same face that David Lawrence owns. Charles tugs at his hair, frowns, struggles to talk, but the words won't come. Then he clenches his fists, hunches his shoulders. Veins in his neck become thick ropes, Looks like he wants to kill. Don't play with me. Who was he? I swallow, but don't answer. Who? Spit flies from his lips, his tone blacker than death. I shiver, but I don't answer. Why are the rules different for you? I ask with force, my rage trying to match his. You tell me to let it go, to forget about you and Jessica, but I tell you I do the same. You. Who? His jealousy rattles the house. He has a Tyson right before the first bell look on his face. I'm ready for him to call me names, grab me, hit me, slap me, squeeze my neck, and bang my head against the wall until I lose consciousness. Part of me wants him to do all those things, would allow him to stone me, then to suffer from the pain he's brought into this house. Another part of me is terrified, telling me to flee, not fight with that dragon. My body is tense, easing into sprinter's position, but he's closer to the door, so I'm trying to decide if I should fight and scream, or scream and flee, or just scream until I die. My voice is unsteady. I've never called you Francis. Never. Then he blinks, exhales in short puffs. The glow of insanity fades from his eyes. I go on, low blow, Charles. Bringing up my pregnancy, that was pretty fucking low. He won't stop frowning at me. What was it, Charles? I'm yelling at him, giving him my anger. Were you being greedy? Was it because she was new to you? Was it just new pussy? Is that what it was all about? Why is it a crime if I do it? And I'm supposed to let you walk over me if you do. He refuses to release me from his scowl and won't blink. Then I say, or did Francis do what he had to do to feel like a man? He blinks. I ride our emotional roller coaster deeper into our insecurities and fear, refuse to let the ride end. He gives me a heinous scowl and I give him a Lorena Bobbitt glare, daring him to do what he's thinking about. And then, ever try to go to sleep inside these four walls, I ask, is that what it's all about, huh? He bites his lip, touches his swollen eye, stands up. I stand too. If we are to fight, if I am to die, I'll be on my feet. Charles yanks up his boxing gloves, slaps them under his armpits. He scowls down on those scattered pages, moves around that black lust inked on white paper, marches away from our truth. His heavy footsteps fade down the stairs. Sweat covers my nose, runs down to my lips. My world is hazy, hot, humid. Air gets too thick to breathe. I swallow. Feel as if I'm suffocating, about to choke on my own saliva. I stand staring at the colorful pictures on the dresser. Our wedding picture is the one in front. Two happy people. I'm in a daze, thrust into an ugly, surreal world, wondering, how do I get back to the world in that picture? Bam, 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 bam. Bam, 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 bam. The house rumbles. The walls shake. It scares me out of my trance. I yell, bumble across the room, bump my knee on the edge of the entertainment center, then yelp and fall, crawl over the carpet, try to remember that stupid earthquake procedure, and hurry and get to the doorway. Bam, 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 bam. I lean against the wall, holding my leg, cringing, the pain bringing tears to my eyes. The house continues to rumble and shake. Feels and sounds like car after car is ramming into the walls. Bam, bam, my home is about to cave in, but it's not an earthquake. It's Charles's raw rage. Bam, 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 bam. Charles is in the garage in his pajamas, punishing that boxing bag. I rub the pain in my leg until it eases up enough to let me stand. The house continues to quake as I lean against the wall, rub my temples, wipe my eyes, take easy steps, limp to the bathroom and blow my nose. Bam, 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 bam. When I look at the tissue, it's stained with soft streaks of red and yellow paint. I gaze at my face and see the beautiful colors, see the fingerprints of another man on my skin. Bam, 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 bam. I limp to the shower. The drumbeat of David Lawrence throbs between my legs. That's the end of that chapter. I'd have told his ass. You want to know who it was? I fucked your bitch's husband. Right. But he'd have probably hit her so hard in her fucking face, child, her whole motherfucking you dig would have been at the back. Y'all know men can't handle that type of shit. Child, bye-bye. He'd have cried like a damn baby while he caved her face in. Hey, Tracy Cakes. Good afternoon, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you, lovey. Welcome, welcome. Child, listen, she didn't tell. Probably smart she didn't. Better to tell in front of somebody like Yvette after Yvette done dialed 9-1 and her finger hovers over one. Better to tell him over the phone when he don't know where she at. Child, listen. Because he is going to cave her whole face in, child. Listen. Oh, my God. So Marvin said, forbidden love is all. Once conquered, more forbidden lust. I would be out. Yeah, listen. But he didn't. He don't feel like a man. He's a pussy. That's it. That's all. Because, listen, he had every opportunity to talk to his wife and say, hey, I need you. He understands her job. He just didn't care. He didn't care, you know, like he was selfish. He didn't think about not just the band on his finger. He didn't think about his wife. He only thought about himself and what he needed. He didn't think about how his actions would impact his wife until after he did what he did. And only then, because it would impact him if she ever found out, when he could have said to her, hey, how you're behaving now is affecting me. He could have talked to her about, hey, why didn't you cry at Papa's funeral when they were driving back to wherever the fuck it is they live after Papa's funeral? That could have been a whole conversation from Mississippi all the way back to the crib. But that ain't what he did. Why? Because he's a bitch. That's why. Because trust me, if the tables had been turned, as a woman, y'all know how we are. We need answers. We ain't stuffing it. We need to know what's up with that. We'd have asked him a question. He'd have thought that he was fucking in the middle of an episode of the first 48. We'd have hit his ass with a barrage of questions, right? Right. And he's a master at what he did because he didn't behave any differently than he always behaves. That's why she thought everything was okay. Yeah. It's the gaslighting for me. Yeah, he's real good at that. And then, you know, flipping the script. Ciao, bye. Anyway, hey, Choco Chip, good afternoon, darling. Thank you so much for sliding into the speakeasy and bringing the good vibes with you, darling. Happy to see you today. Welcome, welcome. Child, listen. Right, no name needs to be this. We don't even know her name. I hope we get to know her name, child. Listen. Not even go sit down, sir. Just go lay down in the middle of the 110 at rush hour. Not at rush hour because traffic be moving real slow. About midnight, wearing all black, just lay down. Yeah, yeah. Just go lay down. I'm like, what the whole hell? Child, listen. Not Charles by bastard. I can't. He's a man, child, listen. 8 months and would have continued. If he not if he didn't get caught, because remember, he didn't get caught. He got his ass beat because his bitch was sloppy. She was a woman in love. She did what women do. We keep messages. We go back and read and reread. And like, y'all, the first text messages that I ever got from my current husband after we started, oh my God, when we crossed from friends into this, child, listen, all that shit. Every time I switch phones, move those messages, right? Because sometimes you just need to be reminded. Ooh, I remember when he was all fresh and new and he used to say all that mushy stuff, right? You need to read that, right? You need to read that when he done broke the goddamn jar of allspice in the fucking kitchen and you got to clean it up. Go back and read that shit then. It'll keep you from putting a laxative in his favorite ice cream. You know, shit that angry women do. Oh my God. All right. So yes, we keep all that. She just got sloppy. She was doing what angry women or rather what women in love do. We keep that mushy shit. So yeah, you can't even you can't be mad. He didn't get caught. His woman got sloppy. His lover. She got sloppy. And that's that. So, yeah, I think he needs to know who. Yeah, he did. He did. A lot of men do. A lot of men do. But that's okay. Right. Let him eat a loaf of Wonder Bread. I wonder who she fucked. I wonder if she sucked his dick. I wonder if she let him hit it raw. Oh, child, listen. His ass will be constipated from eating a loaf of Wonder Bread. I know you lying. No, God. I'd have had his ass blocked up. He'd have been blocked up. The poop won't come out. Yes, indeed. Block the fuck up. All right, so y'all know my cornbread ain't done. Y'all know that already. But y'all still keep on showing up to the speakeasy. What that say about y'all? What does that say about y'all, damn it? Because y'all are here. All right. We all y'all sitting at home like, yeah, what does that say about me? Does that say? Right. And those of y'all at work like, child, you just get me through the day. That's it, honey. Don't get it twisted, child. I'm not crazy. Okay. Got my shit saved in your phone. One click access. I know you lying. Chapter 12. Something nudges my memory. Makes me remember how we started. A little more than 5 years ago, I met Charles on a crowded bus heading to Mammoth. We were on a KJLH and Four Seasons West ski trip. Saw my future husband when I was struggling to toss my luggage under the bus at 6 in the morning. I wasn't interested in him at that moment. He came over and helped me, took charge the moment I met him. I like that about a man. I wasn't in the talking mood, but when I saw him up close, I did my best to sip my coffee and perk up, tried to be grateful for his help. He asked, "You skiing blacks? What's that? Advanced? Oh no, first time taking lessons. Me too. I'll have at least one person to run into a tree with." We ended up sitting across from each other, but I tucked a pillow under my head and went to sleep as soon as I got on the bus. After being up until 2 in the morning, not even a quadruple cappuccino could wake me up. But my people were yakking and getting their party on by sunrise, had the music bumping like it was New Year's Eve, so I had to wake up, and Charles and I ended up talking off and on. We ended up in the same ski school with all that bulky equipment weighing us down, learning how to turn and wedge and falling off the ski lift, then tumbling down the bunny slopes together. We were a disaster. After we'd had enough embarrassment for one day, we turned in our rented gear, warmed up our frozen toes in the crowded lodge, sipping wine and beer, raising our voices so we'd hear each other over the hip-hop remixes that were rocking the building, laughing about how we looked on the hill, then talking about our jobs, dancing a bit, eating greasy entrees. He asked, "What made you get into news, my probation officer?" He laughed at my joke. I said, "Back then, I wanted to help control some of the images about our people. Show that we're not all drug dealers or rappers. Thought I'd get in and change the system." "Yeah, feel you on that. I wanted to change things too." He was looking good in his colorful gear, reds and blues and blacks, and I was without makeup. My perm needed to be curled and was jacked to the max. And that school teacher still kept his eyes and smile on me. I asked, "When's your birthday?" "October 2nd, Libra. Balanced, highly emotional, high sex drive." He asked, "When's yours?" "February 24th, almost a month away, 22 days. Hazel eyes, soft black curly hair, the kind of man you look at, start thinking about pretty babies. Because who wants ugly babies? Not even ugly people want ugly babies." He said, "You said you came up here by yourself." "Yeah, traveling a cappella. Most women won't go to a movie alone, let alone a vacation." "Well, was supposed to come up with this guy I'd been seeing." "But I wasn't feeling CJ anymore, so I ditched him." "Sounds like that's over. It's been over for months. Just didn't need to drag it out and mess up my vacation. Tried to get my friend Yvette to come up, but she had plans to hit Atlanta for the weekend." He laughed. "Lucky me. Since you put us on that page, where's your woman? Don't want to get stabbed in the back of my neck while I'm sipping on my wine." "Dang, that's pretty violent. I work in news. The world is violent. Trust me, I teach social studies. I've studied history. I know about violence. This country was built on violence. There's never been peace on this planet." I nodded. "Well, All I'm worried about is your woman rolling up on me from the backside. Last thing I need is to become the lead story on the 6 o'clock news. He laughed. You don't have to worry about that. So, Mr. School Teacher, you're not seeing anybody? Well, Miss News Producer, I'm not going to lie. I date, but nothing serious. Like I said, don't get me stabbed. Don't worry. I'll protect you from all enemies, domestic or foreign. Yep. You are most deaf a teacher. Later on, we were looking for each other at the big party. It had a New York theme, so there were 400 African Americans dressed in New York blacks, designer leathers and wools, sunglasses and fedoras. I sported a simple black dress. Seems like I always wore black dresses when I went out. I had my face made up, hair curled. Couldn't wait for Charles to see me looking more like a woman than a tomboy. As soon as I saw him, he took control, took my hand, and led me to the dance floor, and we started dancing and drinking and laughing until it was time to shut the place down. He told me, I love the way you walk. I'm bow-legged, slew-footed, just like my mama. She must have a sexy walk, too. We sat next to each other on the bus ride back to L.A., shoulders touching, heads on shoulders when one of us nodded off, comfortable. Like we were already a couple. It was hard for him to catch up with me after that mini vacation because by the time I made it back to sea level, it was sweeps week at my job. He was back to teaching. It was back to reality. But he had my cell number and he kept calling. And I kept calling back. I wasn't exactly waiting for Charles. I did date other men. I was single, not committed to any man. It took me and Charles 6 dates to get into bed. 6 dates spaced over close to 2 months. That was still too fast in my book, but slower than the average 3 dates before sex. That was when I was slave to the chemicals and the queen of the perm. Used to spend my off day at the beauty shop getting my bob hooked up. That was me, a standing appointment down in Ladera every Wednesday, wasting 3 hours at the beauty shop. I try to remember. It all gets mixed up after a while, especially right now. We started out as late-night weekend lovers, pretty much had to with our schedules. He couldn't do the late-night thing on the weekdays. Then came summer, and he was off work, available 24/7. The next thing I knew, we were jonesing for each other. The way he looked at me, said my name. What the fuck is your name, girl? You may never know. The way he laughed. From day one, I loved it all. Then he had more free time and would come by my job at sunset, brought me Jamba Juices and burritos from Baja Grill, listened to me play my sax. Used to tell me that my freckles were like stars in the sky and my face had beautiful constellations. Then he sent me exotic flowers 2 weeks in a row. My heart was softening. I smiled ear to ear when I showed him around the newsroom, took away some of the mystery of news production, introduced my new lover to Yvette. She made freaky deaky eyes behind his back and gave me 2 thumbs up. Charles was fascinated with all the behind the scenes work, wondered if I could come to his school, talk to kids on career day. No problem. Would love to, even if I had to go in there half awake. For him, I'd change the rotation of the world. 15 minutes after he drove away, he called. Missed me. Same here. If you're still up, come over when I get off. The language of the booty call. I'll cook for you. The language of romance. Sure. Or I'd have passes to get into some event or have to go with a crew to cover some premiere and ask if he wanted to meet me in Hollywood or Westwood. And I'd show up in a black cocktail dress, something silky that draped in the back, showed off some flesh, took away some of that wholesome appearance. And he would smile, and that smile made me giggle 1,000 times 1,000. We hooked up after I got off work pretty much every night, and I cooked a late dinner for him. Easier to cook for two than for one, was what I had said, and that had us eating after midnight. Then, with the kissing and his hard-on would betray him, we moved toward the inevitable. His fingers would find their way to my vagina, the way he traced the edges, made circles, massaged that button while he sucked on my breast. That combination was dangerous, made my voice change, eyes tightened, pre-orgasmic growls came from deep inside, famished moans. Then my panties were at my ankles, my skirt pulled up high, his chains jingling as his pants fell and bunched at his feet. Right there, kitchen counter, up against the front door, on the carpet, got to the point that If I knew he was coming over, I wore a skirt, high heels that pimped out my calves and made my butt curve more. No panties. Always played the role and waited for him to make his move, to get past all the talking about our families, about Bible study and church and God, about jobs, beyond all the laughing at each other's stupid jokes, starting off polite, watching the clock, waiting for him to shut me up and get inside me, melting when his lips finally touched my neck, playing cool and aching for the next level, dizzy when his hand held my ass, then his erection pressing up against me, fucking our hearts out, sometimes candles burning, sometimes music, sometimes no time for sensual ceremonies, and going all the way in a room with all the lights on, Venetian blinds cracked for the voyeuristic in my old creaky bed, my first bed from my college days, first with condoms, then lust disguised as trust, numb the sensibilities. I'm not seeing anybody. You're not seeing anybody. I'm HIV negative. You're negative. I'm on the pill. Never miss one. Helps me with my period. Then condoms abandoned for real contact. Move towards recklessness. No barrier. Skin to skin. So intense. Was like starting all over again. He'd sex me a while. Stop. Lay me down and stroke my clit. Stroke. Give me agony, stroke, make me beg, then his tongue dancing inside my pussy, turned his body until invited his penis to find shelter in the warmth of my mouth, taking him slow, methodical, playing his sex like it was my sacks, while being licked slow in figure eights, then using my hand and mouth, punishing him, being punished, trying to make him go crazy before he made me go insane. Me, the woman who looks like a freckle-faced church girl giving deep throat on a Sunday afternoon. Me and the innocent-looking history teacher who dined on my clit like it was a French cuisine. Then lying next to each other, caressing and confessing, feeling high and heady. Couldn't help saying things from the heart. He told me he never met anybody like me. Beautiful. Got that from my mama. Professional. Afraid of failure. Cooked. Got that from my mama. Kept a clean apartment. From my mama. So eager to please. No comment on that one. Not flaky. Too busy working. No time for games. No phones ringing all times of the night. No time for conventional dating. No secret lovers. Not like the typical LA girls. Try not to be a total package. Damn, really? A Renaissance woman. Then he massaged me with hot oils, painted my toes, scratched my scalp, oiled my hair, cooked Cajun dishes for me. Made my heart sing. Always there when I called. Reliable, romantic. The start of our inseparable summer. Then once we were loving, all heated and living inside never-ending moans, and I was exploring his body, squeezing his ass, spreading his cheeks, and I glided my finger toward his perineum. That fleshy part between his testicles and his butthole was going to massage that tender spot because Yvette had told me that takes orgasm to a new level. I overshot my target, touched his back door, and Charles jerked, lost his groove, jumped away, freaked out. He looked scared. Then he grinned like the little boy he once must have been. That left me embarrassed in the moonlight. My words became stutter after stutter, a struggle to ask him what was wrong. Had to pretend I didn't have any idea, or at least be sure. He thought I was going to put my finger up his ass. That made him widen his eyes, broke the mood. I told him no, not unless he wanted me to. He shook his head no, said he didn't go that route. He asked if that was what my other lovers had liked for me to do. I said no, another white lie to him. We all tell small lies, have to save face and not hurt someone's feelings. That perineum thing, I explained that to Charles, said I got carried away and didn't realize what I was doing, that my fingers had taken on a life of their own, laughed to soften the mood, and said that I read that a lot of men like that, a lot of heterosexual men at that, read that in a man's magazine, GQ, I think. Women, too, read that in a woman's magazine. Either way, I heard it takes the orgasm to a new level. That was a hint to try something new, a suggestion that went unheard. Or maybe it was something he chose to ignore. He asked me if I liked that, if I was into anal loving, and because of the judgmental sound in his voice again, I lied, shook my head, and made a disgusted face. Wouldn't admit that because of the orientation of my G, I could orgasm that way too. I wasn't the next Madonna, but I didn't want to give up my Madonna image. And he looked, or rather, and be looked at as a freak whore. Just said that I was still a backdoor virgin and repeated that I had read about that pleasure technique in a book, maybe a monthly like Essence or Honey, articles written by upwardly mobile black folks with no shame on their game. And maybe in Cosmopolitan or Vogue or Tempo, mainstream magazines read by pretty much everybody, and thought he might like it. He chuckled and said real men didn't get into that. He kissed me, entered me doggy, had me in a position where he could control me and I couldn't grab his ass. And he stroked me harder than he had before, loved me like he was the ultimate maxim man with the quintessential dick. That awkward perineum moment came and went. We went on with our summer. Halfway through his work hiatus, we were spending almost every night together. My place, his place, didn't matter. I hated being alone. I was in need. Needed consistent companionship and security. Late night drives up the coast. Lots of talking at Lucy Florence or sipping lattes and listening to jazz at Magic's Starbucks. He was in need too. Restless, lonely, horny. We were human. Needed satisfaction on all levels. He was there. He was available. We moved from being part-timers to having a full-time relationship. A scary transition. He had a toothbrush at my apartment. I had keys to his crib. I put a picture of us up in my living room. He did the same at his home and at his job. I stopped investing in D batteries and my pink vibrator with the clitoris stimulator went on indefinite hiatus. That summer, we were cruising through Lust City into Loveville. In another weak moment, after he had cooked dinner and I had sipped two glasses of Merlot, I got heady, started rambling out my emotions because a slight case of PMS was on the rise, and confessed how I was feeling first, wanted to kick myself. Then he said it too, said the L word to me. I damn near cried, and we kissed a thousand times. Then we couldn't stop saying the L word. Then time went by so fast. We talked about kids, told him I wanted a couple, a boy and a girl. Or two girls. Would hate to have two boys. Too much testosterone. I'd give them both to their daddy. Gotta have a girl to play dress up and shoe shop with. He said he wanted five or six. Have a big family just like his folks did. An old-fashioned man at heart. We laughed about that. I said that I already had a late start and needed to have mine before I got too old. He was surprised that I didn't have any. That was when I was so at ease in his arms, confessed that I was pregnant in high school. Major drama at school, at home, was knocked up by this basketball player who had bad knees and ended up selling crack. He was my first lover, the taker of my cherry. Of course he denied it, disowned me. Of course I had to make a decision, baby or scholarship, become a single mom on welfare, or move onward and upward toward the light. A no-brainer, what goes around. My first lover was killed in a drug bust, tried to shoot a cop. I asked Charles why he wanted to be a teacher, why he was so into his students, because none of the teachers that I had back in junior high or high school owned his kind of passion. He told me his history, that he was abused as a child. The next door neighbor's son, a teenager, locked him in a bathroom and sodomized him when he was in elementary school. Said the guy was huge and he was scared, kept touching his face, calling him Francis, the pretty Creole. Said he loved his smooth skin, his curly black hair, the hypnotic color of his eyes. Charles never told his parents, never told anybody until he told me. His voice trembled. Charles's first name is Francis, named after a saint. But he was always teased about having a girl's name. Charles was his middle name. Again, the name of a saint, but he used that one. A boy named Charles gets more respect than a boy named Fran. I asked him if that was the only time, the only thing that evil boy did to him. He never answered. His eyes were dark, like a television unplugged. Then The television behind his eyes came back on, and he talked and talked, said that he went to the Y and took up boxing, lived at the gym, wrestling, judo, kung fu, got stronger, learned to fight, practiced day and night, and the women conquered as many as he could, did what he had to do in order to make himself feel like a man, was going to get skills and beat down his abuser, always dreamed of killing that man. But that never happened. His abuser moved away. Charles was going to track him down. Then Charles found out his abuser died from AIDS over 15 years ago. He said he salved his soul with a bottle of hard liquor that night, drank alone in the dark, stopped boxing, not all at once, but over time, felt lost for a while, never got his revenge, always wanted to, but never did. That was so sad, the abuse. Then how he abused himself in response to the abuse. I cried when he told me that. He cried too. We both cried a long time, and I fell in love with him. Today, he wasn't fair. He disrespected me, used my shame against me. That isn't my only shame. Just like everyone else in life, I have more regrets than I care to mention. But that one, when thrown back at me, hurt me down to the core. I didn't do the same with his shame. Trust me, I sat there and thought about it. Because for every reaction, there is an equal and opposite reaction. But I didn't take it to the level that I needed to feel satisfied. I felt sorry for Charles, felt sorry for my husband, felt sorry for both of us. It's so sad how two people can love each other and with one decision begin to lose everything you've worked so hard to create. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. What you say, Marva? TMI, no name. Just kick the motherfucker out, please. Not interested in when you met. Marva, like, listen, skip all the hooty hoo sody so and what fors, right? Is you kicking him out or is you leaving? Because one of you motherfuckers need to make a decision around this bitch. You done already fucked David Lawrence, right? I listen, I tell you what, I'm not mad. I'm not mad at all. The chapters are a little long, and I know that y'all, y'all are used to the shorter chapters, but I'm liking this book. Are y'all liking this book? It's only 10 chapters left, y'all. Y'all better be liking this book, shit. I mean, they long as shit, but it's only 10 of them left. I don't know. Then I guess we can start those E. Lynn Harris books or whatever, child. Or maybe I'll be done with the book reading. I don't know. Y'all don't seem like y'all like it. Like I'm wasting my time, child. I could be up here doing something else because y'all be acting like y'all dead over there. Like y'all ain't hearing me or something. Oh, you liking it, Choco Chip? Love Jones said yes. Learning said yes. It is different. And Choco Chip said yes. I'm gonna start calling Choco Chip Chippy. You know, like Chippy from Family Business. You know, that's a Carl Weber thing. And y'all know that song just hit my damn head just like that. We've got a mansion in Dubai. Anyway, let me stop because y'all listen. Wait, Learning said, no, we love the book club. Oh, wow. Okay. I want to know who sings that song and why they sing like that, because it's so nasally. Oh, my God. Okay. All right. So let's get into this this next chapter, child. But I do. I love Chippy. I love that actress. That actress that I see you, Marva. You know what? Let me tell y'all something about YouTube. It takes 10 seconds. When I say something, y'all are actually hearing me 10 seconds after I say it, because from StreamYard to YouTube takes 10 seconds for my voice to travel. Or if I type something into the chat in StreamYard. Now, it takes the same 10 seconds from YouTube when y'all type to get to StreamYard. I don't know why, but it's not just my internet. It's everybody in the world's internet. It's just the delay. I don't know why it's like that. But yeah, so listen, we're going to get into this this next chapter here, because listen, I want to finish this book because I need to know what happened. I really do. I'm annoyed with Charles. I'm wondering what the fuck happens with Charles. Do any of y'all want to know where the fuck Jessica is? Because I do. I wonder if Charles killed her. Or maybe David did with his big gun. Do y'all think David killed her? I wonder if David killed his wife, y'all. Do y'all think he did? I wonder. I really do.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you, Miss Marvel, for tipping your reader. I appreciate you, darling. Thank you so much. Yes, some encouragement. Thank you. Because I'm like, y'all ain't said a word. Shit, are y'all liking it? I know y'all be enthralled or whatever, but y'all, listen. I wonder, though, if he killed her. Because remember, she can, and now guess what? She could get in trouble because remember her dumb butt picked up the gun, girl? You don't touch nobody's door handle and you don't pick up nobody's gun. Why? Why did she do that? She picked up the gun when he was in the bathroom peeing. Remember that? She picked up his gun. Now her fingerprints all over the gun. So if he did off his wife and they find the gun, they're going to think she did it. Dummy. Dumb, dumb, dumb. All right, let's go. Chapter 13. Yvette tells me, you look like shit, Freckles. I know, no sleep. It's more than that. Looks like you've been traumatized. We were in the parking lot at the station, both of us just getting out of traffic that was as thick as a brick. We both end up parking at the far end of the lot at the white stucco and brick wall closer to La Brea. Tyra the Tyrant's convertible Jaguar is already here. That silver chariot resting in her private space that is closest to the door, away from the rest of the common workers. Right now, she's probably in a planning meeting, terrorizing other people whose offices have doors. I don't rush to get in and find out if I still have a job. Yeah, why is she going back? Yvette asks, why didn't you call somebody and let them know where you were? Sorry, moms. Today, Yvette has on faded jeans and a fitted multicolored t-shirt that reads certified lockdown worthy. Her jeans stop right below her calves, are cut low, and show off the edges of her lacy black thong. She has on some funky clog shoes today. The heels make that Amazon 3 inches taller. I have on black jeans, black boots with thin heels, and a pointed toe, real sexy shoes, and a light brown peasant blouse. Kill the sarcasm. Yvette gets serious. Had me freaking out half the night. I ask, you hear about the fire? Hell yeah. 20,000 acres and at least 9 cribs have been burned down. That's going to be the lead story tonight. Tyra will be coming and screaming all evening. We hug each other. Then she hands me a small bag that has a zebra print design. I ask, what's this? Your goodies from the ATL. I keep forgetting to give them to you. I know, Yvette, my body language is screaming that I've had a rough night and my girl is trying to cheer me up, keep me living in the positive before I step into that other world. In the bag is a t-shirt from Atlanta's Underground and a colorful box of Dick Tacks. Ah! She gave her Dick Tacks. Too cute. I shake the candy and laugh a little. What the hell are these? Look at them. I open the small box and shake a few of the itty-bitty candies out into my hand. They are tic-tac-like things shaped like colorful penises. I laugh a little harder. Where did you get this mess? This spot in Little Five Points called Junkman's Daughter. I pop a brown one. She pops two of the same color. Saxman, Mike Phillips' debut CD, You Have Reached Mike Phillips, is one of my gifts. I smile big time. A book is inside the bag, too. I take it out and read the cover. Threesome. How to fulfill your favorite fantasy. I say Dick Tack romantic music, a book on how to do a threesome. Oh, snap. Is there some message behind this? That's not for you. I was looking for that book. She takes it back, laughs all the way to the trunk of her SUV, and tucks it underneath a basket of laundry. While she does that, I open my dented trunk and put the bag of goodies inside, then lean against my car. She stands next to me and does the same. Yvette says, okay, where were you last night? What's up with that threesome book? Research. I ask, where you researching last night? I was home. Self-medicating? Alone. Never medicate alone. Was on the phone with TJ. He has to think I'm an idiot. Nah, thinks you're a crack up. First, I was out on the web researching the Eritrean-Ethiopian thing. Called him because some of his facts were contradicting what I was reading about the land dispute. I surfed the web and pulled up tons of maps from 1902 that said the Ethiopians were in the right. Found another article said the Eritreans have only released one map, and that's a Mussolini's map from around 1935. Mussolini? I was surprised, too. I've seen photos of Mussolini riding with Hitler, so that puts a fat spin on the issue. Flash Hitler's face, throw in some of his atrocities, and mainstream people will be interested in watching. Can't believe the CBS is doing a miniseries on Hitler. You and me both. And they're going to kick ass during sweeps. That's what I'm saying. Anyway, what I pulled off the internet says the Eritreans have other maps that would damage their case, but they're keeping those to themselves. And they bum-rushed the Ethiopians when there was no war, then rejected peace plans. Sounds like you had a romantic night. Didn't mean to go on like that, but you know how I can get. I know. Put me in contact with your neighbor. I'd like to get her perspective. Sure, I'll give Tuesday. Listen, her name is Today, but I don't. Child, listen, whatever the fuck. Then TJ got beside himself. We started having a debate. Then somehow, and for some reason, the conversation changed, and he tried re-educating me on the Hutu and Rwanda. I say Rwanda. We covered that. What? Seems like 10 years ago? At least. Were you in news then? I just started working as an intern. Was trying to be a reporter back then. Long time back when I thought long. Curved red fingernails were hip. That and a jerry curl was underrated. Had to have a gold ring on almost every finger. Sometimes had two gold rings on a finger, and bright colors were the shit. And was dying to get a gold tooth. Yuck. Had that Master P thing going on, huh? Got that from my mama. You should have seen my cousins out in Bessemer. Your Bama butt done changed a lot. Yep. Back when I was hanging out at J.O. Parker, pigging out on the pig and still sleeping on Africa. She reminds me that the Hutu massacred a million. What is this? Is it Tutsis? Yes, Tutsis. She talks on. People over here would rather see a story on only 8% of the French are obese. What's in their diet? Then, jeesh. It's about the dollars, Yvette. You know that. That's why we know all about the Irish Protestants and Catholics, right? And how many more stories can we possibly do about Palestine and Israel? Shit, that neck of the woods is well covered. But Africans in the news? We still don't exist. It's disturbing, don't you think? Yvette, don't get political right now. I'm tired, head hurts, and I've got my own problems. She gets back to her original question. Where were you kicking it at all night? You sound like Charles. We talk underneath Hollywood's 2 o'clock sun and layers of brown air, a combination that will have people with bronchitis popping pills and getting breathing treatments all day. The echo of traffic out on both La Brea and Willoughby punctuates our words, irritated and bad drivers screeching and wailing their way into our conversation. Tyra the Tyrant opens the double glass doors that lead inside. She stands at the top of the stairs, a dictator on her throne, peering down at the peasants. That stops us from talking. Tyra wears a deep green pantsuit, a colorful scarf over her head. She opens a piece of Nicorette, eases it inside her mouth, then folds her arms and stares at me without saying a word, almost daring me to come up those steps and step inside that door. Yvette yells, "What's up, Tyra? You can't speak?" She gazes at Yvette, then at her watch, then back at Yvette and raises a brow. Yvette doesn't respond to any of that. Everyone is rushing, so no one comes near us, but a couple of them give me the thumbs up, letting me know they're my friends and on my team. They do that before they realize Tyra's at the door. Then their demeanor changes. But just as many regard me in a strange way, almost as if they know that there is going to be a fever in the funk house and some static in the attic when I cross the moat and get inside of Tyra the Tyrant's castle. Hang on one second, y'all. Let me get some air on in this bitch. Sorry, y'all. I was sitting here like a damn fool just talking. Forgot I hadn't unmuted. All right. In the midst of Tyra's silent threat, someone comes up behind her looking for her. She goes back inside, cutting her eyes at me until she vanishes. Her little psychological move fucks with my head. Ooh-wee, Yvette chuckles. Looks like Citizen Tyra is going to be in rare form today. I should have hit that bitch in the eye. I give Yvette the real deal about what happened between me and Tyra, about how I drove away and left her begging, then move on and tell her the short version of the rest of the night. Whoa, rewind. You went to see that David Lawrence cat by yourself? I take a breath, try to purge Tyra's bad karma from my system, and tell Yvette about the mountain of evidence. That gets her attention in a major way. To get away from Tyra's eyes, we walk to the side of the building, stand near the corner, and I talk my angst away. Tyra appears at a side door, looks at me, then goes back inside. We walk back around and stop by our cars, continue to talk while our rainbow coalition of Black, white, Asian, and Latin reporters, segment producers, line producers, they all pull into the lot. I notice that a lot of people are here on their off day. Looks like everybody has been called in. That means the world is falling apart, always falling apart. All I care about is my world. That's what I vent about. You're joking. That is all my girl can say. Charles been creeping for 8 months. I repeat, 8 months of roo-goo-doo. And you didn't have a clue? I feel stupid. I hand her a couple pages of IMs. I tell her about all of their dates. Yvette says, he took her out in public? Get the fuck out of here. I nod. Took her to Eurochow. She says, both of them. Sitting up at your fave romantic spot, wearing wedding rings, holding hands, laughing, flirting, looking happy. Yeah, yeah, yeah. On a side note, Freckles, we need to get a copy of this cyber software. You were going to say that. She reads the IMs, and each time she gets to something strong, she cringes. Snap, this is deep. Can't tap dance your way around your own words. Straight up pornography. Mouth open, she leans against my wounded car, reads, and frowns. Once again, I see all of the new dents and old imperfections on my car. Find myself cursing at the damage that has been done. I live in anger. It's not my true nature, but it's my reality now. Yvette lowers the paper, stunned. No wonder homie did a number on his face and his ego. Charles ain't no joke, but that David guy opened some serious kick ass. Looks like that David guy whooped his ass the way Todd Bridges stomped Vanilla Ice. No, she didn't bring that up. No, God. Still, I feel for my husband. Despite the madness, despite what he's done or what I've done, my love for him runs deep. Love and hate live so close to each other. Facts. Yvette says, I read all of those IMs, and you know what I see? Two people cheating, two adulterers, two con artists. It's deeper than that. You know I tend to go deeper than the surface. Okay, what? Two people crying out for something. It's sad. She's crying out for something. He's crying out for something. Maybe at face value, it's just two people getting their groove on the down low. But one of them or both of them could be crying out for help. I don't say anything. Oh, she can't read my thoughts. She asks, what was that David Lawrence like? Arrogant, little cocky, scary. But at the same time, the brother is super intense, passionate, and exciting. What do he look like? He's like Lenny Kravitz and Eric Benet rolled into one. Sounds sexy. That was me talking. Anyway. Weird and handsome. And he likes classic cars. She hands me back the IMs, and I struggle to not lower my eyes. Words getting unsure and shaky, and I tell her about the loft, the art, and obsession with painting Jessica. Describe Jessica the way she was described to me, only I add some nasty words of my own. She keeps saying, fine as hell and likes classic cars. She knows me. She's waiting. I tell Yvette about the gun, the death maker that David Lawrence took to Charles's job, the Colt Defender that is still loaded and waiting. Yvette's face fills with concern. I think about what David Lawrence told me about his legacy, about Route 13 and the Wawa girl that his mother killed. But I keep that frightening and heartbreaking part of him to myself. I slept with David Lawrence. What? I confess that in a shaky voice, a bewildered tone. Don't try to romanticize what went down between midnight and sunrise. I slept with a married man. I keep touching my wedding band, reminding myself that I'm married, wondering if I've made myself a Wawa girl as well. I say, we did it last night. Freckles, are you in his studio? Insane? On a futon. You spent the night with him? Left after we was there a few hours. Got up and left. Went home. Yvette pauses, a look of disbelief etched in her face, and shakes her head. Just like Charles, she sees me as a black Hester Prynne. Can't accept my transgression. Then she takes a hard breath before she speaks. Two wrongs don't make a right. I shrug. Do I look different? No. Why? People who commit adultery should look different. You feel different? Like a person I've never met before. I shift. Sleeping with. Her words fade. What the fuck were you thinking? My girl comes at me with that judgmental tone of a true Gemini. She's giving and caring, very opinionated, but I'm defensive, not feeling any of that judgmental shit right now. My anger gets the best of me. Charles refuses to own what he did, damn it. All that motherfucker had to do was own it and give me the remorse I needed to see. I needed him to be sorry, to cry, to let me be right for a goddamn change. Here's what machismo. Hate that shit. Not that damn arrogance and refusing to answer my questions or do anything I need to get toward some resolution. He tried to turn this around and make it be my fault. She backs down, sighs, and asks me to calm down. I can't calm down. Not before I give up what I'm feeling. No remorse means disrespect, and disrespect means it's going to happen again. She backs down and just listens. I calm a little. I have a lot invested. Too much. I'm losing it all, just like that. You gonna cry? Yeah, that expressive Pisces part of me is in an internal battle. The emotional part wants me to shed enough eye water to drown this city. I shake my head. No, you need to. I wave at a reporter as she hurries into the building. Not right now. The stress, it's in your face. The city's on fire, and I'm in a house that's burning down. Freckles. Go on and go in before Tyra sends a lynch mob after you. Not without you. Can't believe you got with her husband. Why? I think, and this is crazy, part of me wanted Jessica to walk in, wanted to hurt her, wanted to drive that bitch crazy, wanted to fight her, wanted to, I pause and remember how that gun felt in my hands, wanted to do all kinds of things. That's not the way you do it. And I think of David Lawrence's mom, incarcerated while her cheating husband drives up and down Route 13. I say, I know. Her eyes tell me that she hears me, understands me, but doesn't agree with me. Not at all. Her deep sigh is a serious song saying that I'm putting myself in a dangerous situation. She says, let's walk. I follow her. We pass by the guard's gate, wave, and keep moving across Willoughby. Into the single-family homes that lead into the geeks and freaks section on Melrose. I motion at a billboard that's high on La Brea. It's supersized with two actors and an actress from the sitcom Scrubs. I read the sign and nudge my friend. Got milk? Not another one. Yvette's eyes follow mine to that billboard. Is it just me, or do those Got Milk ads look like they just gave somebody a serious blowjob? We stare at the way the milk sits on those two actors and that smiling actress's top lips. We crack up. Yvette makes me laugh when I want to cry. Everyone needs a friend like her. I say, yuck, that does look pornographic. Makes the men look gay and the women look downright nasty. We walk some more, stay on the side of the street with the most shade. Cars are zipping up and down the narrow side street, a tree-lined area with restricted parking for residents only. After she eases me with laughter, she gives me silence. I fall inside myself and think. She checks her watch. I do the same. We know Tyra is waiting. Her game is to rush us. Ours is to not be rushed, to maintain control. I ask, think I was crying out for help last night? Screaming like an old woman does when you step on her corns. She shakes her head. You should have called me. When shit gets like that, we have to call each other. We walk parts of the sidewalk that are uneven and rising as either the aftermath of earthquakes or trees growing and the roots causing the cement to buckle. We're shoulder to shoulder and silent, like two inseparable elementary schoolgirls. I ask, when you did the creep creep on your lovers, what was that about? I didn't trust them anymore. Didn't feel secure, wasn't anchored to the relationship, or was anchored to somebody I didn't trust and wanted to be unanchored. I bite my bottom lip. Anybody ever find out? Only one guy did. This guy I was mad in love with. I told him just to spite him, and he went insane. Broke into my apartment. That immature troglodyte was drunk as a skunk. I mean, he had lost his mind. Kicked my television over, slapped me around, was dragging me down the hall by my hair and screaming, "How can you let another nigga penetrate you? How could you let him put his dick in you and invade my property with his sperm?" You gotta be joking. Thank God I had that Jerry curl and he couldn't get a good grip on my greasy hair. Guess that curl was your first line of defense. Then he wanted to fuck me. You joking? No joke. He kicked my ass and got a hard on. He wanted to have sex with you? It's about power, not sex. I stopped walking. He raped you? He was too drunk. He got it up, but I wouldn't let him get it in. Damn, Yvette. I was so scared. Her pager goes off. She checks it, frowns, then looks at her watch again. Then my pager goes off. We both turn around and we head back, moving a little faster. I say, Pavlov rules. You know it. Damn electronic leashes. Finish your story. Anyway, I got away and locked myself in the bathroom. Called me all kind of whore, screaming at me like he didn't have nothing to do with it. One minute, his drunk ass was crying and telling me how much he loved me, how he wanted to marry me, wanted me to have his babies. Then the next he was screaming that I made him do it all, made him break in, made him jump on me, just kept kicking the door and going off on me. Sounds like that psycho had a chemical imbalance. Couldn't say nothing to make his ass calm down and leave. How long did that go on? Hours. He didn't leave until the next afternoon. When I came out, he had trashed my place, punched holes in every wall, broke every picture. I say, I understand. Do you? You're schooling me on the down low. She repeats, ain't no forgiveness for women. Men do that shit and start all over. Get reelected, pedophiles put back in the pulpit while we get shackled to our reputations. Still amazes me how men expect us to just get over it. Then they fall apart. A lot of these educated fools still have that Nigerian Muslim attitude. They want to sentence you to death for creeping. But they ain't criminals, haven't committed a crime. I say, the wacko who attacked you, he was the only one you tipped out on. Oh, please, she chuckles. Come on now, you know it's all part of the game. I was out of the game. You're never out of the game. That's why the golden rule always applies. I say, you're only as faithful as the man I'm seeing. I smile a little. That should be on a t-shirt. Print them up, and I'll stand on Crenshaw selling them for 15 a pop. Buy three, get a free bean pie. Now you're thinking. I ask, what about your Eritrean lover? Yvette sighs. He's cool, but he's young. Uh-huh. What can he do? Had the nerve to ask me how many partners I've had. We laugh. I ask, and you said, luckily he asked me about the men here in Los Angeles. The way she says that makes me laugh again, this time much harder. She says, I do a state-to-state rule. I'm a born-again virgin once I cross state lines. Cool rule. Made that rule up when I was in college. Trips to Atlanta, Tampa, New York, sex on an island, or on a weekend ski trip. Hooking up with an ex on vacation, none of that ever counts. We high five that rule. She amazes me every time I see her, always makes me feel better. Yvette catches her breath before she goes on. I mean, if a lover ain't all that, I shouldn't have to take credit for a bad performance. Oh, hell no. Bad sex is a candidate for selective memory. It just didn't happen. Another high five. She says, and if I didn't come, that can't count. Oh, hell no. No way. If the need was not met, then the action did not take place. Double high five on that one. I say, you have some good points. If I didn't come, it wasn't sex. She says that and smiles at her own words. That should be on a t-shirt, too. Hell no. That should be on a blimp. We pass. pass by the guard shack again, this time cackling like teenagers, wave again and head back over near our cars. Again, I think I see Tyra at the door, but I don't look that way. Refuse to give her the attention she's demanding. My girl looks at her watch and I do the same. The laughter eases up. Stress lines grow in her face, my expression mirroring hers. Freckles, she says my name with concern. Work isn't the alpha and omega of her world. I ask, what? That David Lawrence guy, what about him? You use a condom? Of course. Just want you to be safe. Charles already has you at risk. Try not to think about that. She's a true friend, and it hurts me to lie to her, but I feel like I have to. She asks, last night, you come? Oh, God, he was a pussy-eating king. He ate you out just like that? Again, flashbacks make electrical tingles run through me. I smell him, feel his echo. The sex, it sings. The primal chance, the oblivion, that animalistic state we were in. I say, yeah, I came, so it counts. It amazes me how some of these brothers will just stick their faces in the coochie without knowing you from Summer's Eve, and do it without a second thought. Charles is a Libra and owns a pretty strong sex drive. I know him. He had to be the same way with Jessica, as intense and as enthusiastic as he was the first time he was invited into my body, eating her out like she was the buffet of the week, impressing her with his moves, then coming home and kissing me, giving me Jessica's essence with a smile, holding me while her fingerprints stained his body, her invisible paint all over his flesh. I wonder how they fucked, if they were as primal as those IMs make them sound. That porno plays before my eyes, Jessica's name in bright lights, her dark face with the slanted eyes. That image becomes the lead actress in an endless XXX movie. I make it vulgar, make her the queen of whores. I can't bring myself to romanticize and give any meaning to their tryst. Can't think of what they did as making love, no matter how many times they did it. I have to keep it at a rude and rudimentary level. Yvette and I make a loop around the building. She asks, was he a decent lover? He was a P.E.K. Okay. Could he work it? Oh, yeah. He has that tongue vibrating thing down to a science. But David Lawrence, despite my scrubbing myself with my own soap, moisturizing my flesh with my own lotion, covering myself with my own perfume, his scent remains on my skin. I feel his girth inside my body. His rhythm lives. That drumbeat refuses to die down. My mind makes me cling to him as if he's the only thing that keeps me from going insane. And I know that Jessica's scent lives on Charles's skin, seeps into his pores. She's part of him for eternity. In a flash, I think of all the days and nights I've tried to please him, made my body available to him as an offering of more than sex. What is love as my gift to him, as his friend, as his wife, and yet all I've done hasn't been enough. He blames it all on me. I told Charles that. My words fade as I try to think of the right word to use. I remain honest with myself. Told him I fucked somebody last night. No, you didn't. You're joking, right? I tell her that I was so pissed that I told Charles I'd had an affair, but didn't tell him with whom, and that drove him insane. I tell her how he was tripping, then breaking down, then asking to work things out, then how I thought he was about to kick my ass, then he was down in the garage for over an hour, rocking the house, trying to destroy that boxing bag. She snaps at me, asks me why I did such a stupid thing. I confess, and look, okay, I didn't use a condom, shit. What were you thinking? It just sort of went down, you know? No, I don't know. How could you not protect yourself? I have no real answer. All I can tell her is that I don't want a lecture. Don't want her to make me feel bad or stupid. But Yvette is Yvette, and she does lecture. She does make me feel bad. I have no answer. Sensibility flew out the window, and I got caught up. Again, I feel like a criminal for lying to her. A new guilt shows on my face. I feel like I've committed another transgression, and now I have to confess to feel better, need her to give me atonement. You're out of control. Her words affirm. Stay with me until I'm not abandoning my home because he fucked some bitch. Freckles, no. He reminds me that she speaks from experience, and those memories put some trouble and tremble in her voice, some fear in my heart. She holds my shoulders, looks me in the eyes, and sounds tense and firm, scared and concerned when she rants on and says another thing. We open the door and stop, or rather step inside. The temperature drops, becomes a new season just that quick. Tyra waits down at the end of the hallway. Her expression chills me even more, consumes the last of my warmth. She shakes her head, walks away, both hands in fists. Yvette says, looks like she's gonna give you the silent treatment. Whatever, I'm already freezing. Televisions on all over the place, monitoring news on other stations as well as ours. Some are on the Steve Harvey Show and other sitcoms. At least one is on MTV, another on BET. And with all the equipment in both the offices and the control room, the place has to stay cold as a morgue to keep all of that high-tech crap from malfunctioning. My cell phone rings. It's Charles. My heart wants me to, but I don't answer. I get to my doorless office, to my secondhand desk that sits in a field of open desks that yield no privacy, open my purse, take out two Tylenol, and pop them without water. They go down rough, but they go down. Yvette stops by her desk for a hot second, then takes her sweet and sensuous sachet toward her editing world, her saunter and charisma lighting up the warehouse, black, white, Latin, or Asian. Everyone stops and smiles at her. They all love her. Tyra passes by, shrieking and screaming at a co-executive producer, a tall, bony, bearded, Pee Wee Herman-looking guy who dresses nice and has some switch in his stooped walk. I check with the assignment people, and they give me the rundown on all the breaking news, then check the wires to see what's up in the country and the rest of the world so I can step into the meeting with confidence and knowledge. Can't sit in a meeting as a producer and have no clue what they're talking about. Today, it feels as if my job is on the line. First chance I get, I stick my head into Yvette's editing world. She's working her ass off and bumping Nellyville, adding some funky tracks to a hip-hop segment on the dance called the Crip Walk, being banned at Crenshaw, Manual Arts, and Washington Preparatory High Schools. She speaks with sarcasm, real important stuff. Skip Africa and go for the Crip Walk. We talk about another package on the man who killed his co-worker this morning. Try to see how we can pump it up and make it more sensational than it already is. She says he only killed one person, same race. That's not news. That's your final answer? That came straight from Tyra. It'll be a filler. When we're done with the business, she says, one more thing, Freckles. Sup? You're vulnerable. Love and hate are so intense, make you lose sight of who you are. I understand. Keep away from that P.E.K. Her words are strong and like a mother. She sees right through me. I leave. Again, Charles calls. I wait until the last ring, then I answer. His mood is different, no longer arrogant. He asks, can we meet for lunch? No. That slows his roll. You coming home tonight? Don't know. He sounds depressed, as if he's not sure what to say or how to talk to me. Like a stranger, he asks, this guy, was it somebody you used to go out with? Why? Are you planning to see him again? Is that your only concern? Is that what got your attention? Are you? You violated the covenant first, Charles. I hang up. My lip trembles. He calls again. He's irritating me to the max. I say, stop calling me. I need to talk to you. I'm working. Don't do this to me at work. Always your job, right? What didn't I do for you? Your job is more important right now, huh? Guilt hugs me, won't let me go. I think about his eye, those shades of blues and blackness, that redness from it becoming bloodshot. I ask, how's your eye? It's okay. He got in a lucky blow, huh? That bothers him. He makes a sound that is a mixture of pistivity and irritation. I say, take Tylenol, ice it. Beating up that bag ain't gonna help. How you doing? How the hell do you think I'm doing, Charles? I catch myself trying not to have a fucking breakdown. That's how I'm doing. And you know what? If it wasn't for my job, the way I can maintain, if I didn't know how to be a cold-hearted bitch, I didn't say that was how you described me. That's why you betrayed me with Jessica, right? Because she's so damn sensitive. Because she doesn't complain and make your head hurt. Baby, you don't after all that. Why would you want to be with a bitch like me? Why would you want me But everything you said in the emails tells me that Jessica is the better woman for you. Those were words, just words, your words. I'm sorry. I fucked up. Look, listen, what else can I say? My breathing shallows. I peep around to see if people see me losing it. A couple of people are at their desks, on computers, on the phone, all watching me. I turn my back to them. I gotta go, Charles. Wait, what, Francis? What, Francis? What do you want, Francis? That shuts him down. I say, my car is jacked up, my neck hurts, my stomach is upset, my leg has a big bruise on it, my husband is cheating, and my heart is broken. That's how I'm doing, Charles. He says nothing. I ask, and how are you? Look, I'm sorry for the things I said. It was your truth. Don't deny it. My voice returns to calmness. Another part of me reminds me that he is still my husband, and I'm still his wife. I say, put some ice on your eye. Food is in the fridge. Make sure you eat. You know how your head hurts when you don't eat. And make sure there aren't any clothes in the dryer that need folding. I hang up. The phone rings again. Emotions swell, and I hurry away from that chime, keep my eyes down, and pretend I'm busy reading notes on a clipboard, and slip away to the green room. Make it there before I have a huge emotional breakdown in front of everybody. Struggle to lock the door, then fight to pull myself together, wipe away a million tears. A while goes by before I regroup and tip out to the bathroom, wash my face. Then, as I redo my lipstick, stare at the woman in the mirror. The image startles me. Her freckles beg her to smile. She does, but her red-rimmed eyes reveal the wounded soul within. I step into the control room and someone says, "You look really tired." "I'm okay. What's the matter?" "Nothing. Stop sweating me." "My bad. Somebody needs to pop a mite off. Throw her some raw meat." Laughter at my expense as I flip them off. I have to get back to working. No matter where I go, people keep asking me if I'm okay, and I blame my sniffles and rosy cheeks on my allergies. Try to laugh it off, then keep moving. Have to keep moving. Stay busy. Go into overachiever mode and become superwoman. Over and over, I pass Tyra in the hallway. All evening, she does her best to kill me with silence. I put a story on her desk. 2 minutes later, it's back on mine, mutilated and redlined to death. I make changes and put the story back on her desk. Again, it ends up on mine, redlined, top to bottom. She fucks with me all evening. I can't do anything right by her today, not one thing. She has that quavering air of superiority, moves as if this place is Asgard, and she is a female Odin. The last time we pass in the narrow hallway, she's munching on fries in a supersized McDonald's box. We slow and give each other contemptuous eyes, but no one says a word. Whenever we're near, the building closes in on us, becomes a square boxing ring. I have a million things to keep me distracted, including a ton of voicemail messages that came in after I left yesterday. Most of them are from Charles. Each time I hear his voice, I make grunts that sound like, "Fuck you," and "I'm disappointed," and "You're so pathetic." I don't listen to his words, just push save. As soon as I hear his voice, I want to delete his messages, but I'm not there, not ready to purge him. I want him to keep calling. One is from David Lawrence, my sinner in bohemian clothing. His voice invades my senses. First, a chill runs over me, then fire creeps up and down my spine. I swallow and close my eyes. If we did it once, it's the same as doing it 100 times. David Lawrence says, "I was served with the divorce papers this morning. The money in my account is looking funny. Check yours. And I think your husband filed assault charges. We were man to man in that fight." That's punk of him. My headache deepens. His voice softens. "Call me." I hang up, hesitate for a moment, and then I return David Lawrence's call. He's not there. I'm relieved. Want to talk to him? And don't want to talk to him. I leave a message, my words jittery, businesslike, and brief. I tell him thanks for the information, but don't ask him to return my call. I call Wells Fargo, check the balance in all of our accounts. All of our money is still there. The balance is off by a few dollars, but not enough to worry about. I'm not the best at balancing the books. Then my office phone rings and I answer, asking who's calling. He says, "It's Mr. Irritating." It's David Lawrence. He actually laughs. He asks, "Remember that?" I groan. I was really sort of drunk the other night. Sort of. I'm feeling really embarrassed over here. He asks, how you feeling today? Stressed. I got something you can do. Close your eyes for a minute. Remember popsicles, lemonade, and running through sprinklers? I smile and fall into memories of being a little girl in North Kakalaki. Being a kid with kid concerns long before life plagued me with grown-up problems. He tells me, I read the, don't know what to call the papers you left here on the futon. Those are a copy of my questions, the ones I gave to my husband. You want to know a lot. You should want to know the same. Then he gets quiet. I say, hello, I'm here. Sup? He says, first, about last night, we should talk about that. I pause. We're serious now. I say, go ahead. Don't really have any idea what to say. That wasn't the real me, you know. It's okay. Just say what you want to say. No, you first. I'm surrounded by people, so it's easier for me to listen right now. You got the message, so you know my situation. I ask, divorce papers? Process server came by at the crack of dawn. I shrug. Sorry to hear that. Our wedding anniversary is this weekend. That's, damn. How many years? 3. Wow. Some anniversary present, huh? Seen her? Nope. Think she's hiding out in Palm Springs. She has family out there. She hasn't been back home? As far as I'm concerned, she has no home. Not with me. I went by the house and changed the locks and the code to the alarm. She can't get in. Wow. 3 years. I'm on my 4th. Yep. She tried to drain the accounts and made plans to run off with your husband. That annoys me. I say, Charles didn't quit or move money. Never packed a bag. You sure? My money is fine. What'd he say? Charles admitted the affair. To a certain extent. Before or after you showed him the IMs. A little of both. But he said he wasn't leaving. Not in the way Jessica told you. Yvette passes by in a deep conversation with another segment producer about a package. She doesn't see me, but her presence makes me conscious of what I'm doing. I pick up a pen and a notepad, furrow my brow, pretend I'm scribbling down important information. There any way I can see you? He asks. For what? To talk face to face. Not a good idea. We already need to yell 10 Our Fathers and 10 Hail Marys, murmur an absolution, and get dismissed with a reminder to love God and sin no more. You're right. Wait, I suck my top lip. There's a place near here, the Hot Wings Cafe. Okay, I might be able to meet you for a few minutes at sunset. But you're not sure? I ask him to hold on when a writer comes to my desk to ask me about a story on the high suicide rate in prisons. Before I get done with that issue, someone else needs me to answer a few questions. It takes me a couple of minutes to get back to my call. I apologize for leaving him on hold. It's crazy around here. What time at the Hot Wings Cafe? Let's scratch that idea. Too many people from here eat over there. That would be a problem. I wouldn't feel... It'd be a problem. Wait, it wouldn't be a problem. We can meet over there. No, over on Melrose at Jamba Juice. Up at the Beverly Center. Damn, let me think. Where's your sax? Huh? What about sax? Sax, S-A-X, your horn. In my car. I want to hear what kind of music a floor-sanding sorority gal from a marching band at Johnson College in North Carolina plays on her alto saxophone. He remembers most everything about me. 48 hours ago, I didn't know he existed. 24 hours ago, I hated him. Now I'm worn and he's making me smile. I reply, can't be any worse than that country western crap you listen to. He laughs at my attempts at humor. His tone gets an unexpected smile out of me. He says, I listen to a few, but Tim McGraw is the only one I dig enough to buy. Sure, I'll drag you away from listening to the white man's blues and studying about the deconstructionist bowel movement and school you on some Kim Waters, give you some jazz. Deconstructionist bowel movement? He laughs harder. Come see me tonight. That will be late. You know, close to midnight, about the same time you came by last night. With an innocent tone, he puts his desire to continue his vengeance out there. His soft voice makes my vagina moan. I'm not breathing, holding the phone and remembering last night. I say, if I come by, well, I need to get a copy of that software you have on your computer. Want to put it on my computer at home. Think he might have other women? Have no idea. No idea at all. Come get it. I say, if I come, let's get this out in the open. All I want is the software, so don't expect anything from me but music. I'll stay a minute, long enough to play a couple of songs, long enough for herbal tea, a little music, and a short conversation. What do we have to talk about? We'll play it by ear. I rub my temple, cross my feet at the ankles, and squeeze my thighs. I remind myself, all we have in common is our spouse's infidelities. Pretty much, God, how do we end up here? Infidelity spawns infidelity. Silence. I say, you were hurt. I was hurt. We were in pain. We comforted each other. How you feeling right now? At this moment? Yeah. If I was to go to church right now, the building would probably crumble. I stare at my wedding ring. Remember a white dress and black tuxedo, honeymoon in Maui, vacations to Florida, ski trips to Canada, laughter and smiles and promises. A picture of Charles sits next to my computer. Cherubs and photos of my man and me are in my face. I tell him, one phone call and you changed my life forever. Your husband changed mine. No, your wife changed yours. She made herself available. What's your husband's excuse? I'm not making excuses for him. He touched my wife every chance he could get. Read those IMs again. Your wife opened her legs anywhere she could. Yeah, she did. You're the one who found a condom wrapper in her ride. I guess a man can only do what a woman lets him. We hold the phone. Bad news is blooming. Everybody's going off the deep end, screaming, hollering, yelling, cussing. And right now, the station is demanding my full attention. David Lawrence breathes slow and easy. I have flashbacks, his breath and anger on my skin. I want him to say goodbye because I don't know how to end our conversation. He hangs up. I sit holding the phone, my mind muting out all of the screaming, hollering, yelling, and cussing. I'm remembering North Carolina, growing up on Rosedale Avenue, walking through Forest Hills, seeing a house with large glass windows. That was my dream home. I'm remembering popsicles, lemonade, running through sprinklers. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, that fucking chapter took 47 minutes to read. I know you lie. Oh, her chapter's too long. No, it's his chapter. This is I'm thinking of woman. Listen, I need a moment, y'all. Listen, this book. I'm in the middle of it. I want to just go back and just open up like a flower and let him pollinate her like a honeybee. Is that bad? Does that make me a bad person? I don't give a fuck. I want her to fuck David Lawrence as many times as Charles was poking around in Jessica's pussy. Yeah, that's what I want. If they don't make it like that, I... Fuck. Anyway. Oh, y'all talking about shit that don't even matter. Oh my goodness, child. Listen, hey, Jess Valencia, good afternoon, darling. Welcome, welcome. Not lurkers, kings, queens, and village people. YMCA. Wasn't that the village people, child? Listen, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Oh my God. I want her to get off work early and go fuck him a lot and just film it. You know, I want them to fuck like a lot. Right. How's your eye, motherfucker? That's what I want to know. Hey, Daisy Star. Good afternoon, darling. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. And that game, Daisy, I don't even know how you play that game. I'm torn on that game, but we're not going to talk about it. Oh, my goodness. It's real life. Sometimes I feel like helping people is a good idea, and other times not so much. No, God. Anyway, I'll stay on the fringes of that game. Anyway, y'all, I have given you guys, I'm scared to give y'all one more chapter. I don't know how long this I don't know how long this chapter is going to be. Let me see. Hang on, because I want to give y'all one more chapter so that we keep it at four chapters, but I'm scared. I'm scared. Let me see. Hold on, I'm coming. I mean, I'm not coming. I'm just saying I'm still scared. I'm scrolling through to see how many pages. All right, I'm gonna give y'all this chapter, and then I'm gonna leave so I can go watch a episode to give y'all that. Or would y'all just y'all tell me what y'all want me to do? I seen y'all talking about it in the chat, child. Listen. Oh, I'm still turning the pages, child. Listen, we ain't even made it to the next chapter yet. Oh my goodness, 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 goodness. You know he made these chapters. I just finally got to the next chapter. Okay, let me see. And it's 1 o'clock. Right, let me get y'all this fucking chapter, y'all. I don't want to hear shit else from y'all. No complaining in my DMs. When you gonna read some of that book talking? I don't want to hear about it. Okay? Because y'all be doing me dirty. All right, let me wet my whistle right quick. Chapter 14. I have extra clothes in my Mustang, so I choose to crash at Yvette's. We get to her place, and we're both wide awake and restless. Dealing with Tyra the Tyrant and Charles has left me stressed out to the max, and I could use a nice glass of wine. But I don't want to have another claustrophobic pity party, so we hop in my baby blue and go for a ride. I cruise Ventura Boulevard, pass by Jinky's Cafe, Baja Grill, and a million sidewalk eateries. When I cross the 405, she tells me to keep going toward Encino. She tells me to make a few quick turns, and we end up cruising through a high-end residential neighborhood. I ask, where are we going? Hofmagandi. What's that? She tells me that Hofmagandi is the unwritten name of the swingers joint. Its name comes from an old Scottish word that means fornication. And they practice Hofmagandi here with no boundaries. The house is on a side street that runs parallel to the 101 freeway. A nice sized home in the middle of a residential neighborhood. Stunning topography. Hidden in plain sight. Everyone parks two blocks away, then walks down. There's a short, thin, clean-cut man at the gate. He's hardly big enough to be a bouncer at a kiddie party. He smiles, asks us who we're looking for. Yvette says the magic word, and he opens the iron gate and lets us in. Yvette looks at me and says, relax. What if we see somebody who knows us? Well, they're up in here, too. All right. Well, they're up in here too. We walk underneath palm trees, across a lot, and step into a house filled with thirsty souls searching for satisfaction, willing to drink from any pool. People are wandering through the house like vampires in search of blood. One sister has on a long leather coat, wide open, and all she wears underneath is a long, oh, I'm sorry, a leather thong and a bra. Knee boots and Mickey Mouse ears that have Disney World stitched across the front. She stops next to me and talks like she knows me. I got a man who I'm not sure about. Huh? She repeats herself. I play along. What's the problem? I know he likes to fuck, but I don't think he's as open as I am. She adjusts her Mickey Mouse ears. I like to be talked to like a porn star, and he doesn't do that. Too bad. But that's what happens when you marry a minister, I guess. She smiles. You're cute. Thanks. A guy passes with a bowl of condoms, reminding me of the peanut vendor at Dodger Stadium. His bowl is filled with all kinds and all flavors of protection. Relationships are hard, the woman with the Mickey Mouse ear says. Just when I think she's done, it's a full-time job, and we ought to treat like one. What you mean? If your lover wants to bounce, they should give you 2 weeks' notice, severance pay, and before they go, they should have to find you a temp. We laugh a little, but I'm laughing at her, not with her. She smiles. You want to do something? No, thank you. She makes a disappointed face, the kind a brother makes when he asks you to dance and you turn him down. Then she smiles over at Yvette. What about you, Strictly Dickly Minnie Mouse? Catch me next lifetime. She frowns and walks away, adjusting those ears. I say, geesh, talk about a few loose screws. She was a little ya-ya in the sisterhood department. A brother walks in and worms himself into a conversation with Yvette. The men around her, men around here waste no time. I listen to him try to feel her out. He was born in Nigeria, then went back to Ghana, then to Botswana. Has been in this country for 13 years and is leaving soon to work on his master's somewhere overseas. He's intelligent and has her ear. Around us, the big screen has on a hardcore XXX movie. And Yvette and the guy are talking about how beautiful Botswana is, about Zimbabwe, about Namibia, being off the hook, while moans and grunts fill the air. She asks, what do you know about the Eritrean-Ethiopian conflict? I leave them chatting and go to the kitchen. There's a crowd there, too. I go through the refrigerator like I'm at home, eat some chips, then pour myself a glass of Riesling. A bow-legged, handsome, golden guy walks in, sporting jeans and a Kentucky sweatshirt. He's a six-footer, clean-shaven, built like an oak tree. He makes his way over to me and starts a conversation, very polite and gentlemanlike, but still coming at me hard. He tells me that he is originally from New Zealand and is an undercover drug enforcement agent. I say, I always thought you were supposed to be undercover, not getting under the covers. He laughs. I ask him about his wedding ring. Without hesitation, he admits that he's married about 6 months into his vows. He asks me about mine. I tell him I've been married for 4 years. He asks, how's it going? It's going. He asks, you want to do something? No, thanks. He shakes my hand and walks around checking out the rest of the swingers, then gets into a conversation with a Latin lady. She's wearing a blue and white schoolgirl uniform, sucking on a lollipop and carrying a small whip. I people watch for 10 or 15 minutes. Lots of new faces are coming in. Lots of people are walking by, sipping on beers, eating chips. At least two girls look like they're barely out of high school. The men gravitate toward their apparent youth and assumed inexperience, follow their blonde hair and blue eyes from room to room. A lot of people partner up and vanish to all parts of the house, and I don't see Yvette. I get worried, hoping she hasn't been kidnapped and turned into a sex slave. I quicken my stride and walk from room to room, from session to session, and finally find Yvette standing around the fireplace in the master bedroom, watching the show. Yes, my favorite thing to do, watch. My heart rate slows when I find her. I pretend all I see is no big deal. We stand in the thick of the crowd, hold our drinks, and watch the DEA have sex with six enthusiastic ladies, all of them looking high rent and educated, like doctors and university professors. The DEA is putting on a show, sometimes working with two of them at a time. Says Yvette. Now that's what I'm talking about. I say, for real though, the DEA smiles at me, a stimulating lover who gives them orgasm after orgasm. One by one, they gather their clothes and stagger away in post-coital bliss. Me and my girl walk around after that. I'm tingling, moist. The environment is mixed. No low-rent people in sight, mainly upper-middle-class people of European pedigree, ages from 21 to about 60. Yvette says, let me know when you're ready to bounce. Let's look around, and then we'll raise up out of here. We float from room to room, then drift outside, hunting for the best action to watch. Fellatio and cunnilingus is in full swing at poolside, but it's boring to watch. At least that's what I tell Yvette, but she wants to stay. We blend in with the elite audience of intellectual and unemotional connoisseurs. One guy is attentive. His wife's mouth is open, breathing ragged, face tense like she's about to scream, moaning and orgasming in a tone that sends chills up my vagina. Her husband is so into pleasing her. For a moment, I'm her. He's my faithful lover. Maybe Charles wasn't into me sexually anymore. Maybe he was pity fucking me. There were times I needed him so bad. He was sleeping and I'd cry myself to sleep. Just wanted to be the best of everything to him, his lover, his wife. Wanted to have his children, as many as he wanted. I gave 400% of myself and still came in second place. Yvette taps my shoulder. You okay? Yeah. We move by those writhing people and go to the guest house. All the rooms have doors. The shy people are out there. We can hear them moaning through the thin walls. There are a lot of different rooms, some with open doors. One candlelit area has a large bed that has a rainbow coalition of people on it. In another room with soft lighting, it looks like a butt-naked sorority meeting. Women are pleasing and touching women. It's not my flavor. But it's more sensuous. We watch them too. The minister's wife with the Mickey Mouse ears is the best carpet muncher in the bunch. She has the room hot enough to get third degree burns. For an hour, I wander and watch people in search of carnal knowledge work it out. Walk from room to room the way a person tours a museum. It's a major turn on. But it's sad too. There is no love in this house. And without love, sex is violence. We head back through the main house. The DEA traces his lips with his tongue, then smiles at me as we keep going toward the door. Stops me long enough to take my hand and say he hopes to see me again. I take my hand away from him and ask, is it that easy? What you mean? I pointed his wedding ring. He says, stay a while. What for? He laughs the laugh of the world's greatest lover. I wave my ring finger as my answer. I ask, your wife know where you are? He answers with another laugh. The DEA tells me bye-bye and heads back inside. I wave goodbye to the crowd of sex athletes and hedonists and head away, sashay out into palm trees and darkness, Yvette right behind me, sipping on bottled water. I leave, tingling to the point of aching. I tug at my locks as I drive us into the night, top down, crisp air cooling us down. Yvette says, you're quiet. Thinking, what? Wild. All the men up in there with wedding rings on. Yvette says, a man's need to come takes over. That's the bottom line. I ask, what's the women's excuse? They get to dominate. They pick. They get to be love goddesses. I hum out a curious sound. People have no idea these places exist. People know. Yes, indeed, they know. They're in every city. I went to a private club in Charlotte. Whoa. You went to my old stomping ground and didn't tell me? Thought I did. I would remember that. Actually, it was outside of Charlotte in Fort Mill. Drove over there from Atlanta. When was that? Back when Miss North Carolina gave up her title because of those naked pictures. I pulled that story off the wire. That wasn't that long ago. Me and a friend stayed in downtown Charlotte at the Adams Mark. Hit the poetry at Club Aqua. Partied at CJ's. Then the next night, we hit the private spot in Fort Mill. Fort Mill ain't even on a map. Hadn't ever heard of it. How'd you find out about it? On the internet. Are you serious? They have a web page. Damn. I let my left hand dance in the wind as I drive in the crazy traffic on Ventura Boulevard. Bright lights, plenty of people are still out on the strip. Bottom feeders in search of pleasure. Come on, fess up, Yvette laughs. You was digging Hogmagandi. It's actually Hogmagandi. I say hog because piglets will. Anyway, stay out of my business. Yeah, but I was kind of disappointed. What up? Most of the guys, they weren't that cute and they were, you know, regular sized. And they didn't really do nothing impressive. No foreplay, no afterplay, nothing sensual. No pretense freckles, no deep and slow kisses, no romance. I wanted to see romance. Girl, read a book. I drive towards Studio City. All the shops are closed and the Jerry's Deli down this way has burned down. The closest JD is a nice drive from here. We're hungry, but we decide that we aren't in the mood for JD tonight. LA is a county that loves to sleep. My cell phone rings. My home number glows on the caller ID. It's Charles wondering if I'm coming home. I don't answer. Just cut the phone off. Our last conversation left me too spent. Yvette asks, How was it when you were watching me and TJ? What? I know you saw us. You saw me? Yeah, saw you stumbling and staggering around the kitchen. Was that intentional? Don't flatter yourself. No. But after I saw you, TJ saw me? He never said, but his rhythm changed for a sec. Couldn't help hearing you on the phone trying to whisper and arguing. Drunk people always whisper louder than they talk. Damn, he has to think I'm a dingbat, an alcoholic, and a peeping Tom. It charged us up, took it to another level. Yes, God. Yeah. Vague images come to mind, me stumbling toward her door, seeing them in the bedroom, the expression on Yvette's face. From what I remember, he was working it. Truthfully, he ain't that big in that department, but I like the guy, so it's satisfying the way he makes me feel. He's real gentle when he needs to be, rough when I want him to be. When it comes to that, he's a good listener, a damn good student, straight A's. All right, TJ. Then why don't you just stick with him? We've only hooked up twice. Then kick it with him and see what's up. She shakes her head. The law of diminishing return. What that mean? It's my take on an econ theory. And it means the more often we experience something, the less effect it has. If a man sleeps with you a lot, it loses its value. Not true, Yvette, but okay, girl. He gets tired of the same old bump and grind. Wants new pussy. No, he wants new experiences. You can give it to him, girl, if you know what you're doing. Anyway, that's me talking. Sorry. I don't think that law applies to sex. She says it does. Doesn't. Why do men cheat when they already have a willing partner at home? I answer opportunistic. Why do some women get their freak on the down low when they have a man? Emotional void. You need to come off that idiotic crap. Be real. If you ask me, I cut her off. And I didn't. The excitement of the unknown hypes it up. Doing wrong is a turn on. Hell, the sister can be a beautiful Oscar winner and she still has the same problems as a butt ugly mud duck. The law of diminishing return creates a very vicious cycle. I ask, where do you come up with this mess? I'm a thinking woman's thinking woman. You really need to come off that Oprah crap. No, serious. I understand men better than most women. The way they really are, as opposed to how we would like them to be. Read all the books you want. Go to all the seminars. Face it, we can't change them. They can't change us. Let them be them and keep it real. Do you like Charles? She speaks his name and I cringe. Don't go there. She goes on. You give him everything. I show him my love. And it wasn't enough. You can stop reminding me anytime you're ready. No, let's talk. You cook for Charles out of love, not servitude. And I love to cook. You clean out of love. He can hit it when he wants. We're married. I get just as much out of it as he does. Hell, I get more. It's too available. Available has no value. Available gets boring. Yvette. That's why even great sex gets predictable. It's easy for him to turn you down. That's some lonely single woman bull if ever I heard it. I'm just the messenger. Don't hate on me. I mean, I know it's a dichotomy because I've been married. I've been where you are and you're in the right. That's what you're supposed to do. And you get burned for it. You were doing what you were supposed to do, loving him. And there was no pretense. That's just who I am. I'm not like you. You think I'm into pretense? You know what I mean. Pisces rises and anger rules my tone. That heats her Gemini blood and she shuts her down. Oh no, and shuts her down. I drive in silence for a couple of lights. Yvette hums and plays with the wind. She knows I want her to say something, but she keeps quiet. She knows I can't stay mad at her. She says she's a realist, but I think she's a frustrated idealist. Frustrated because she knows that idealism sucks. In her own heavy-handed, keep-it-real way, she's always trying to educate me. She has a huge heart, wants the world to be perfect, but she knows it isn't and has grown to accept it the way it is. She recognizes the passions and the sins, acknowledges the madness and dreams of the human heart, and she lets them be. Day after day, my girl sees the same idiocy, hypocrisy, and brutality I see, and we don't try to change what can't be changed. I love her because she's pure. I know what I'm talking about, Freckles. Her voice is curt. She's emotional. I can tell because her Bama accent always flares up when she's pissed off. That's why every relationship I've been in, the first kiss was just the beginning of a long goodbye. I don't like you saying that. The thing about dating in LA is that you're always breaking up with somebody, always between relationships. Even when you're in a relationship, you're between relationships. You're so damn cynical. I don't like it either. But when you're single again and again, those are the facts. You happy? I'm happy. She laughs a little. I'm happy with my sex life. I mean, with your whole life, more to life than sex. I have my freedom. I can go out to eat if that's what I want or go to a play. And for the most part, I enjoy my own company. I'm out of that codependent phase. Are you happy? I answer to no man. I'm on hiatus and I can have fun on any playground I choose. I can explore the things that being in a committed relationship keeps a woman from doing. Is that what I have to look forward to over the next 5 years? That? And more frequent rectal exams, pills that won't kill the monster cramps, fibroids, reflexology won't work, and my it all will be a joke. Oh yeah, it's gonna be a blast. But I'm still miffed to the max. I don't wanna think about divorce, not tonight. Just wanna have fun and pretend life is good. Thinking about $30,000 in legal fees alone makes my head hurt. And losing the house, that's major. LA is a dual income city. You can make $40,000 a year and still not be able to afford a good house. And if you find one, it's a fixer-upper that looks like Fred Sanford's crib. And divorce, can't deal with that concept right now. Divorce is second only to the death of a spouse on the psychic pain meter. Death. Then divorce. People have chronic attacks behind that shit and panic attacks too. Flip out and spiral down into major depression. I tell her to kill the mad face and tell me what she's thinking. She says Eritrean. That gets us both laughing. Then she asks, true or false? Yvette, come on now, let it go. The first time a man sleeps with you, it's powerful, has the full effect. Like crack. That's me talking. Anyway, she can be so stubborn. I give in to her conversation and nod. I'll go with that one. You never get that original effect again. That's some bullshit. Anyway, all you need is a little jalapeno. Anyway, it doesn't diminish. It can always be good. Sometimes it gets better. Indeed. She says, let's just agree to disagree and change the subject. I'm not agreeing with that crap. It's all about the excitement of the chase. The sperm chases the egg. The egg doesn't chase the sperm. The egg is stationary. It's settled. It's in their nature, the perpetual chase. I'm cracking up. She says, so it's a man's destiny to hunt. What's a woman's destiny? To buy shoes. I'm laughing too hard to drive straight. I ask, how do you come up with this bullshit? This is Bama talk, right? She laughs with me and shows me two middle fingers of love. You need to stop running like Flojo and find you a steady man. Why don't you meet one of those nice southern men on those trips back down to the ATL? Nothing but a bunch of gay men down there in Atlanta. Going into Lenox Square is like stepping into a Little Richard and RuPaul convention. That bad? Brothers are switching up and down Peachtree, acting more feminine than I'll ever be. And there are too many bisexual brothers down there. That's messed up. They are taking that brotherly love concept to a whole new level. Damn, can you imagine catching your man with another man? I'd mess around and have to kill a nigga. Now, that's the end of that chapter. Listen. Okay. Yeah. Oh my God. Well, listen, I did that. I want him to get no name to it. She never went to his house. She said she was gonna come by when she got off work. But she didn't go over there because her and Yvette went to Trip to Life Fantastic at Hoffma Gandhi. Y'all need to listen. So wait, now it's okay to swing, but judgment on the affair? Yeah. Yeah, because listen. She just watching. Yeah. When people go to swingers clubs and they're married, they know what's up. They going for one or two reasons, to watch or to participate. I like to watch. So, yeah. Daisies. Yep, same here. Okay, she better go ahead and get a little. Listen, I don't even. She said they be switching around Lenox Square Mall. Child, listen, I don't know, because I wouldn't even be going shopping in the malls no more. Shit, every time you turn around, it's a shooting in a mall. Shit, I know you lie. Amazon, bitches. Point, click, stay safe. Shit. All right, y'all. I'll have to come back later because all of y'all, it's 1:24 where I live, 2:24 on the East Coast with the people who are in a hurry, and over there on that weirdo coast over there, you know what I'm saying? What is it, 11 something? Almost 11:30. Yeah. So they getting ready to have lunch. You know, that's lunch. For the Southerners, lunch. A little lunch. So I'll come back in a little while. Right now, I'm going to go and watch an episode of this show, child, so I can give that to y'all, because I swear, y'all really want me to get there, honey. And one of my moderators, so proud, she all the way up to episode 10. We don't give a fuck. No, we do. We do care. We're glad she's there. I got to catch up now. For a change, I'm behind. Ooh, let that marinate. All right, y'all, listen. I'm going to get out of here. I love y'all, okay? Yeah, look at her. Look at this shit. Happy. Yes. All right. I'll be back in a little while. Let me go watch this and take my little notes, and then I'll be back. All right? So I love y'all as y'all make y'all way through these pothole-filled YouTube streets. Please be careful, okay? Thank you, moderators, for keeping us safe. And listen, y'all, if you do nothing else, please, salute your spirit and protect your peace. All right? And until I come back, I'm out. Hey, real quick to all my day ones. Y'all remember when I first got this little music, the opening and the closing? Like, remember how excited I was? All right, I'm out.